Deck. How you doing, guys?
Thank you.
Watching a film, but then all of a sudden we're in a film.
Roughly 5,000 meters above sea level. To give you an idea, that's about 700 meters on top of Kilimanjaro.
Where's the cyclist still going?
My talk tonight, as you gathered, I'm not going to do like a proper presentation. I'm not going to do a sort of a show. I'm going to have a chat, really, and show you a few bits and pieces, and be a bit laid back, and tell you a little bit about my journey with Claudio von Planta, cameraman for Long Way Round, from the Iranian border across Iraq into northern Iraq, into Kurdistan, and to Mosul, to the front line. And a bit about me, Billy Bike Truck, born in Liverpool, but brought up in Ireland. Liverpool, famous, of course, for the Beatles. And also for the football, yeah, famous for the football. But what a lot of people don't know, famous for environmental issues. Years ahead of our environmental. And like you look around the world now, the whole world, all of the major cities removing cars from their city centres. All of them removing cars from their city centres. Liverpool, let me tell you, 45 years ago, you go out on a night out in Liverpool, go to theatre, go to cinema, park your car. When you come back, that car's been removed, okay? Way ahead in the world, yeah. So fair play, well done, Liverpool. But I was brought up in Ireland, and in a little place, beautiful little place, just near the border between the south and the north. And a lot of the media used to call it bandit country, but a beautiful part of the country, Carlingford, O'Meath, County Louth, County Down, just a stunning part of the world. My mother was a bit of a mad Irish Catholic mother, and she married a pretty sad British Protestant father, a British Protestant man. And I don't know how you know the whole Irish thing, because I'm sure some of you do and some of you don't, but that whole Irish thing for a young Irish girl, Irish Catholic girl, to be going off and marrying a Protestant British man, I tell you what, that was so fecking complicated. I mean, it would have been easier if she married a horse. It would have been less of a controversy if she'd have married a horse, I swear to God. And where we come from, in that area, where I come from, me and my siblings, we're seen as mixed race, yeah? I mean, that is genuine. So that's where I'm from. Some people know me as Bike Truck. I don't know whether you've come across that, and you're probably thinking, well, why did he call him Billy Bike Truck? Well, back in the day, I'll just share my screen with you here so we can crack on. So back in the day, I used to take bikes, put them in a truck. I'd take bikes from the UK and from Ireland, from Scotland, put them in trucks. It's about 15, 20 years ago. Put them in a truck and take them to Africa, right? Bikes in the truck. So that's where I got my name from, Billy Bike Truck. And I know some of you are probably thinking, hold on, Irish Gypsy Scouser. Don't even go there. All them bikes were genuine and legit. And by doing that job, it got me right into the motorcycle game. I was right in the history of the whole motorcycle game. And by doing that, I ended up working with a guy. I'll show you this guy now. You'll hopefully recognize him. So I ended up working with this guy, and I manage loads of his projects. I manage all sorts of his projects. By the way, it's the guy on the right, not the guy on the left. I wish it was the guy on the left. Sorry, Charlie. But it's the guy on the right. If it was the guy on the left, I'd probably be loaded, but it's the guy on the right, I'm not so much. But and I do loads of work with Charlie all around the world, which basically means me riding motorcycles around Africa, South America, Central America, Australia, literally all over the world. And I know it's hard. And just the guys here in the Long Way Down, when they went from the top of Scotland all the way down to Cape Town. And I also work with this guy here quite a fair bit, done a couple of TV shows with the guy on the left there. That's Ross Noble. Ross Noble used to live in the UK and now lives in Australia, and pretty massive in Australia, pretty big in the UK, but pretty massive in Australia. And in fact, I'm here now. My window is that way. And through my window now, I can see the North Sea. So I'm in the beautiful, glorious Whitley Bay. It's very adventurous around here. And it is a beautiful part of the world. The Northeast is pretty gorgeous. And just up the road is where that man used to live. Yeah, Ross. I've known Ross since he was about 15. And he used to do comedy clubs down here in Newcastle. And I used to go and see him doing comedy clubs. And he was doing comedy clubs illegally. He was only 15 and his dad was taking him to these comedy clubs. Well, I don't know whether you know, but Ross Noble is proper bike rider these days. A lot of people just know him as the comedian, international man of comedy. But actually, Ross is like proper out there. He's done the Romaniacs rally. He's done the Roof of Africa in Lesotho, if you know that one. He's done the 6-day Scottish trial. I mean, he's done the 24-hour. I did a 24-hour race with Ross, and we did it for a TV show. And to show how good he is, okay? And we came, I think, 36th. We did it as a team, one bike, two riders. And, you know, 3 hours on, 3 hours off or whatever. And we came about 36th. And then latterly, Ross did the same gig on his own, 24-hour race in South Wales. And headed up by Nick Plum. If you know Nick Plum, anyway, it's his event. And this time he did it on his own. And he won. He won. So without my help, he actually won the 24-hour race. So that gives you an idea of the caliber that you're looking at here, you know? So, but he's a cool guy. I've done a lot of projects with him, tour managed him. I was with him just a month ago. I was sort of trapped in Australia about 2 weeks ago. I only got back 2 weeks ago. I was trapped in Australia and I had a good time with Ross. So Ross was touring when all the lockdown happened. And proper rider, real McCoy. What a lot of people don't know is I'm also a trained safari guide. And trained by this company here, Eco Training, based in Southern Africa, based in South Africa. And they're registered in South Africa. But I'd like to draw your attention to that left bicep. I mean, just check out that. Look at that left bicep. That is a proper, that's a proper cool bicep, that. For a 75-year-old bloke, that is, I'm pretty impressed with that bicep. I'll move on. So this is a crocodile in Zambia, just out of the Zambezi. And this crocodile had been eating people. He'd eaten about, I think it was eight people. If my mate Ian is watching, he can confirm this. I think he'd eaten eight people. He's about 4 meters, four to five meters, and very angry. And he had to be moved. This was the day we were there. We were moving him from that pool. I don't know how good the clarity is, but if you look in that pool behind him, there's a whole lot of lady crocodiles. And the problem is, he was in that pool, and we're not sure whether it was eating them or shagging them, or it could have been a bit of both. And anyway, long story short, we had to move him. And the way, I'm qualified, okay? So qualified. So this is the way you actually move a crocodile. You basically have to approach it from the right end. And that is the right end, by the way. And he was nearly a ton, 1,000 kilos. I mean, I don't think he even knew I was there, to be honest. But he was a bad boy. And we ended up moving him by holding bits of meat in front of him. Bit by bit and inch by inch, he would move and move and move, following the meat. And you'd have to give him a bit now and again, or he'd get bored. Now then, I want to show you a video now. Okay, it's only a 2-minute video, and the boys have got it on the server, so it works better when you show on video instead of you doing it through Zoom because of the way this is working. But the boys are going to show you this video in a second, and it's basically a little bit about me, because what we're doing here, I hope you're getting to know me a little bit. And I want to get to know you. So when we finish this, I want you to all stand up and say a little bit about yourselves, you know, what you do, where you're from. But for now, let's see if we can run this video first, and then we'll come back and we'll crack on. So can we play that video now, please, boys?
Here I am in the northeast part of South Africa, in the middle of the bush, miles and miles away from anywhere, and I'm learning to be a guide, learning to be a ranger, if you like, for simple words. And one of the big things I've learned in the heat of this paradise of a bush is always wear a hat.
Nudity, I reckon I probably got away with it. Partial nudity is okay. So that's me training thing in Africa to be a guide, a safari guide or a game guide. And that was a pretty amazing time, by the way, training over there, fantastic training over there, really, really loved it. And then we'll crack on now and show you this. Now, this is a bit of a plug now. This is a plug. I'm sorry, guys. I mean, you know, we're all in here to make a few quid, like. And this is my nudie calendar. Yeah, it's a full Monty calendar. Of course, this is month one. This is January. And so the way it works, and you can buy this on the site after the gig, okay? So you can buy this. So this January, then February, I take the jacket off, and then March, take the t-shirt off, and it goes on like that right the way through to December. And don't get me wrong, like, December's pretty messy, you know, it's a bit, you know, a bit ropey. But that's you know, that's my nudie calendar. It can be bought online after the gig. And also, I just point out, because I am a good kind of a guy, that all the proceeds from the nudie calendar, all the proceeds go directly to me. So just like to make that clear. So Billy, you're a lucky bastard. You're a lucky bastard. You're living the dream, okay? Well, I do get that a lot. Billy, you're a lucky bastard. But more often I get, Billy, you're a bastard. I do get that a bit more often, to be honest. And this is me. One of my favorite photos, actually. This is me in South America. That's a semi-active volcano there behind me. And I really love that picture. We use it a lot on stuff like this, because it works well for stuff like this. But yeah, and living the dream, you know, lucky and living the dream, I probably not really. Let me think now, how lucky is this? I married a top end, very successful, an absolute winner of a divorce lawyer. Now you tell me, was that lucky? Was that lucky? Yeah, I don't think so. I think we make our own luck, and I don't think I'm lucky, actually. I also want to get over to you a little bit about my philosophy, and in this little chat, and my philosophy is a bit like what it says there. Say yes to everything. Just go for opportunities. If you get an opportunity, go for it, because we're actually not here very, very long. You know what I mean? I'm 70 now, 70 years of age, and I'm on that slippy slope down. I've been to the top of the mountain, and it was brilliant, but now I'm on the way down, and you haven't got a lot of time. So if you're thinking about getting that new job, or packing that job in, or going to go and ask that woman out, let's go for dinner, go and ask her, okay? Pack the job in. If you're thinking on selling a house and doing one, do it. Just do it, because you won't probably get that same chance. You might get other chances, but do it. Go for it. So my philosophy: say yes to most things and take risks. Now then, this man here, Mr. Charlie Borman. Because of my work with Charlie, I was very, very lucky to come across this guy. Through Charlie Borman, I met Claudio von Planta. Cameraman extraordinaire, absolutely cameraman extraordinaire. And he's a proper wacky kind of a guy. I mean, he is wacky. He's a bit eccentric, extremely clever, very, very clever, an unbelievable professional cameraman. And if you ask either of them two guys next to him there, either of them will tell you absolutely that this guy, he was one of the key elements to make Long Way Round as successful as it was. I mean, absolutely, he was one of the key elements. And, you know, he might be a bit wacky. He might be a bit strange. He's Swiss as well, by the way. He's Swiss, but he has this... do you remember there used to be this TV program on called Hello, Hello? Do you remember Hello, Hello? The full of Madonna with the big boobies, they all speak with this, like, French resistance kind of an accent. Like, do you remember that? It was on years ago, a British comedy. But he speaks with this comedic accent, even though he's from Switzerland, not from France, okay? So French resistance, I know. But he's absolutely amazing. And you know, here he is. He's a king gardener, as you can see, king gardener. This is him on the right. Maybe the kind of flowers he messes around with are part of his eccentricity. I think perhaps they've got something to do with it. And that's him on the left there. I don't know whether you've seen him much and stuff, but he always wears that shirt and he always has them trousers on. All the time. If I probably if I show you any other pictures tonight, he will be the same again. But he is an incredible guy. And if you remember now from Long Way Around, just to remind you, cameraman from Long Way Around and Long Way Down and Long Way Up. He was the cameraman from Long Way Up. Okay. So, but remember now, guys, he was the one who just days before they were leaving, he tells them he hasn't got a passport. And his mother, this is a 40-year-old bloke, his mother has to fly in with his passport from Switzerland. This is the same guy who just days before they're leaving, so the Long Way Round is ready to go, Ewan McGregor's there, Charlie Borman's there, they're all packing, everything's cool, and then he, all of a sudden, has to do a confession. And the confession was, he didn't have a motorcycle license. And Charlie Borman was really funny. Charlie often tells this story where he said, Charlie's in HQ. Remember, they had that great man cave, that really cool man cave, the Long Way Round headquarters in London. And they were all there. And Claudio is standing there. And Charlie, and Claudio goes, Charlie, I wonder can you help me? I'm looking at my license, my driver's license, and the piece for the motorcycle, it seems to have disappeared. And Charlie doesn't take fools. Like, you know, Charlie doesn't mess around. Charlie went, what are you talking about? It's either there or isn't it? And he goes, no, it's not there. He didn't have a motorcycle license. He blagged his way into Long Way Round, blagged his way into it. And it took him three times to actually get his license. They had to fly him back. They had to fly him back from Russia. Yeah. So, but what a character. And what people underestimate Claudio, I think, because they don't know his background. This is me and Claudio at the bike shed. So we decided to go to the bike shed to start our trip as a bit of a PR thing. You know, we went to the bike shed. I don't know if you know the bike shed, but the bike shed is a really, really cool restaurant, bar, cafe, lounge area, motorcycle, custom builder, hairdressers. It's got everything. It's so, so cool. It's in Shoreditch in London. I'm just about to open up a new place in LA, in California, and Charlie's involved in it all, that kind of thing, which is really cool. And it's a bit like, for any Australians watching, it's a bit like, good morning, by the way, good morning, Australia. Any Australians watching, it's a bit like Deus, yeah? So Deus Ex Machina. So, but anyway, so we went there, and I don't know if you agree with me, but Claudio here, does he look like a skinhead? Does he look like a fascist, racist, Nazi, booty kind of, he does, doesn't he? He does. And I think I look quite cool. Oh, we're all dressed in Revit gear there, by the way. Well, that's all Revit gear. So Revit really supported us on that trip, which was really cool. You know, gave us some nice gear to wear anyway. And this is the bit that people don't know about Claudio. So Claudio, this is way back, this is Afghanistan. So do you remember when Russia invaded Afghanistan? And do you remember we were all on the side of the Mujahideen? So Mujahideen, what a great word, Mujahideen. So Claudio went over there to carve out his career, just went over there, knocked on doors and said, hey, my name's Claudio von Planta, and I want to film your plight here fighting Russia. Can I join you and document it? And they said, yeah, of course you can. Yeah, come on, join in. So he embedded himself with them. Look at him. I mean, he's proper Mujahideen there, like, you know. But notice the camera, by the way, guys, for those in the know. Notice the camera. That's a film camera, okay? That's not a video camera. So this is in the 90s. This would be the 90s. And they're looking, what a good-looking young man there, right? Look at that camera. Some of you film buffs will be going, oh, look at that. That's a 7008 Pro. And look what he's filming. I've taken these shots from footage. Look, he's in the middle of battles here. In the middle of battles. Look at this. I mean, this is like a rocket launcher, and he's standing there next to it. I mean, this would have been so dangerous to be involved in, eh? But you know, the interesting thing that I think it really does get me is that we were supporting the Mujahideen then. We were against the Russians then, okay? So the Russians were the big baddies. They'd invaded Afghanistan. Oh, the big bad people, them Russians, okay? And of course, a few years later, like, we've invaded Afghanistan, and we're fighting in Afghanistan. But we're the goodies still, and we were the goodies then, supporting the Mujahideen. It's funny the way the world moves, eh? And something that I think I've learned from a fair bit of world travel and into the Middle East, Afghanistan and Iraq and places is that, you know, world politics is not about right and wrong. It's not about good and bad. It's about I swear to God, it's about power, it's about finance, and it's about oil. That's what it's about. Finance, power, and oil. And if you cast your mind back, anyone who's my age, you will have not heard anything only trouble in the Middle East. Like trouble in the Middle East, you know, in Iraq, in Syria, in you know, in Palestine, in Israel, you know. And where did that all come from? That came from that struggle for them three variables. That's where it came from. And if you go back to the fall of the Ottoman Empire, okay, go back to the First World War, when the French and the British carved up the Middle East. They carved up. We're, you know, they say you reap what you sow. Like, you know, it was all sowed by, you know, by the Brits and the French cutting up the Middle East. And I know I'm simplifying it, but you get my drift, you know. Well, we'll have that bit because why? Because there's oil there. We'll have that bit. Why? Because we can get to the Mediterranean to get the oil from that other bit to the Med, you know. There's a great book which I dug out, by the way. If you ever get a chance to find out a little bit about the Middle East, okay? I don't know how good that comes across there. But this is a really cool, A Line in the Sand by James Farr, great book. And it really puts in historical terms and factual terms. You know, it's not someone's perspective. It's pretty factual about how the Middle East was carved up and how it became, you know, what we see now, basically, like, you know? So anyway, one thing I have learned is, don't get drunk with Claudio, because I ended up having a few drinks with him in the morning, actually, like a brunchy thing in London, lives in London. And from there, that led on to a few more drinks and led on to afternoon drinks and led on to dinner. And we both basically got pretty hammered. And this is going back about 2.5 years ago, something like that. And in that hammered two blokes talking bollocks evening, Claudio was going on about the Middle East, and I was going on about Africa, because I'm a big backer of it. I love Africa. I think the continent is just forever, you know. You can, anyway. But during that conversation, it got a bit heated, and he was saying, "Hey, Billy, when are you always going on about Africa? Africa, all the time, Africa. When are you going to go and travel somewhere with more challenge, more of a mission?" And I was going, "What are you talking about?" I said, Claudio, I'm a qualified guide. I've got a certificate. I'm registered. I can go anywhere. You should go to the Middle East." I went, "Claudio, I can go anywhere, mate." 2 weeks later, I swear to God, 2 weeks later, I get a bing in my office. In my office is upstairs in my Wiki Bay house. And I open it, and it's an email from Claudio. And as not unusual with Claudio, there's no writing, okay? It's just an attachment. So I click on the attachment, and to my horror, it's a flight to Iraq. A return flight to Iraq for 2 weeks' time. I'm thinking, what? I didn't agree anything. And then, bing bong, I get a WhatsApp pops in on my phone, and it's from Claudio. He goes, "Hey, Billy, I hope you got my email. We go to Iraq in 2 weeks, and we go to the Iranian border, and we arrive from Iran through northern Iraq, through Kurdistan, and we go to Mosul, the front line, and we will film the fighting." And I'm thinking, whoa, hold on a minute, Claudio. I don't remember agreeing to any of this. I mean, I didn't agree to any of this. I mean, certainly did not. But Claudio got a little bit of an idea after our evening of alcohol. And this is what happened. 2 weeks later, we're on a flight from the UK to Turkey, and then Turkey into Iraq. And, you know, I was reasonably anxious, you know. And we're sitting on the plane, and by the way, I actually do a live show all about the full depth of the journey. But of course, we're not going to do that here now. But I do a live show, and if you do see the live show coming your way when all the lockdown finishes, please come along and hear the full story. But this is a bit of a snippet from it. I hope you get that. But anyway, we're coming into land, and I'm a tad nervous, to be honest, I'm a little bit tad nervous, because we're heading to Mosul. I don't even remember, if you remember, but Mosul was the place that, you know, that ISIS had been cornered in Mosul. It was their last stand. And the Iraqi army, the Iraqi militia, the Kurdish army, the Peshmerga army, all supported by, you know, the coalition forces, bombers and blah, 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 they were all hammering them in Mosul. And that's where we were going. And I still couldn't it wouldn't work in my head, really. I'm thinking, why are we going to Mosul? My three children in England said, Dad, why are you going to the frontline thing? It's on the news every night. And I was saying, it's just an adventure. And I fell back into that, say yes to most things, you know, just take an opportunity. What an opportunity. And to go with someone as cool as Clive. So we're on the plane and we're coming in and we're just coming into land. And one of the worries was that landing in a war zone, because remember, it was classified as a war zone. Landing in a war zone in the dead of night, the people that I know in the security game, they always say, oh, no, best landing in the daytime. You should have got a daytime flight landing. And I went, oh. So the two main things I was worried about was landing in a war zone in the dead of night. And the second one was being beheaded by those nice guys in ISIS. They were the two main things. I'm not a needy kind of a person, but they were just the two main things. And so I'm quite nervous. We're coming into land. And then Claudio leans across to me and says, Billy, just in case there's any trouble at the airport, it might be best if we split up and we meet at the hotel in 2 days. I went, whoa. What's that about, Claudio? What do you mean? What are you talking about? And he said, just in case of any trouble. And I went, well, there shouldn't be any trouble because the airport was a civilian airport. Fine, it was in a military zone, but it's an airport used by civilians. So I wasn't expecting trouble. I could get trouble in Baghdad. We could get trouble in Kabbalah. We could get trouble in Mosul. But, and I was tense now. So I'm going, why should there be trouble? Why should there be trouble, Claudio? And he goes, oh, nothing. We're literally landing now. I said, Claudio, you tell me what? Why should there be trouble? He said, Billy, it's best you don't know. And I said, oh no, Claudio, tell me why should there be trouble, Claudio? I'm proper tense now, and you know, really tense. And then Claudio says, okay, I tell you. And we were arguing like a man and wife. You know, a man and wife, and they're arguing in public, and they're trying to argue, and they're really pissed with each other, but they're trying to keep the voice down, like, you know. And I was going, Claudio, what do you mean? And he said, okay, I tell you, I'm smuggling something into Iraq. I went, you what? You're smuggling something? Are you kidding me? And he goes, yes. I said, what are you smuggling? He goes, I'm smuggling a military drone. It's a military drone. It's going to be really cool. We can fly with it. They'll never detect it because it's a military-style drone. We're going to be getting great footage. I'm going, Claudio, a military drone? Into a war zone. He said, they will never find it. It's at the bottom of my bag. Are you kidding me? I said, Claudio, I mean, you know what it was like? It was like going on holiday to Morocco with your mates, and you're coming home, and as you're landing in Heathrow, one of your mates says, Billy, by the way, know that marijuana? I never threw it out. I put it in your bike boots. They'll never find it. Oh, yeah, no problem at all. Claudio, they're never going to find it. No way. And I said, Claudio, you can't bring a military drone into a military zone, okay? That's a good little play on words there. And then, and he goes, yes, they don't like it. It's they think you're spying. And I went, oh my God, you know. And my big worry, you know what my big worry now is? I'm not worried about being with ISIS, the whole beheading thing, that's all gone out of my head now. Now my biggest worry is we're going to get arrested in Iraq, and we're going to get arrested in Iraq. What for? For spying. That's what we're gonna, that was my big new concern now. That is my concern. And you know what? The scariest thing, the biggest scariest thing ever is that when we get arrested, because we have the Foreign Office numbers in our phone, little tip there, Foreign Office and Embassy consulate number in my phone, and the people we're going to have to ring to save us is this man here. He was the Foreign Office minister when we went. Now, if you don't know, our current Prime Minister. Yeah, I know. This isn't a joke. This is actually it. And I thought, Jesus, we've got to ring Boris Johnson to come and rescue us. For those in the know, last time when he went to Iran to rescue someone who had a prison sentence, that poor person got extra time after he got involved. Yeah, that was scary. Anyway, so we're going through the queue, and Claudio says, I said, Claudio, give me, we're in security. Give me the name of the hotel. Give me the name. I get my pen out and I say, give me the name of the hotel. Because you should have told me this before, Claudio. And I'm pretty cross now and scared. And I go, give me the name of the hotel. And he goes, and we're moving. And there's loads of military in that round. And he goes, middle of the night, by the way, middle of the night. The only other people in this airport are military. There's masonries, there's military, there's security. There aren't families like with little kids and buckets and spades all going to the desert in Iraq. It's military. And then there's an old bloke, an old Irish scouser with white hair. And there's a Swiss guy with a comic accent. That's basically who's there. And we stood out like a sore thumb. And I'm thinking, you know what? We're going to get away with this. I think we're nearly through security, and we're going to get away with this. And then all of a sudden, on the tannoy, you hear, Claudio von Planta. And I went, oh, shit. Give me the name of the hotel. Give me the name of the hotel now. And he goes, the hotel is I went, what? I went, oh, Claudio, I can't even say that. Never mind, write it down. So I don't know where we're going. I don't know the fixer. I don't know any plans. And I'm proper in trouble now. And then all of a sudden, clearly, this military guy walks over, security guy, all armed to the teeth, and says, Mr. Von Planta. And he goes, yes. He said, please come with them. And they take Claudio away. And I'm in the queue thinking, shit, this is really happening. They've taken Claudio away. And I'm looking at them take him away. And as I'm looking, they look back and they look at me and the guy goes, hey, you, hey. And I go, oh. He goes, are you together? You're together. And I went, No. And I shuffle forward into the passport queue thinking, oh my God, they've took Claudio and I've just denied him. I've denied knowledge of him. I don't know him. He's my mate and I've just denied him. And I'm an Irish Catholic. Irish Catholic. Do you guys know what that means? Irish Catholic. Do you remember Judas? Does anyone know Judas? Read the Bible. Judas, he denied Jesus three times. Denied him three times. I've just denied my mate. And I swear to God, for you Catholics and all that out there, I was waiting for next for a cock to crow. That's what I was waiting for. I mean, little bit late there, but came in just at the last minute. And I'm thinking, Jesus, they've took Claudio. And now I shuffle forward. So I'm in the passport. I'm at the front of the passport queue now. And now I'm just thinking freedom. I'm thinking freedom. Get my passport through. Get out. Find a hotel. Wait, see what happens. And then so I give my passport to the passport guy and he opens it and he looks up at me and nice guy. And he goes, hey, Mozambique, Afghanistan, oh, El Salvador, Bolivia, Zimbabwe, Peru, Zambia, Chile. You've been to many places, Mr. Ward, many places. And I said, yeah, I have, yes. And he goes, yes, many places. Are you security? And I said, no, not security. He goes, are you military? No, not military. Oh, you missionary advisor? No, not at all. No. Oh, bouncing. And he goes, what is your purpose? What is your purpose in Iraq? And I went, and we'd already agreed this, okay? This was the plan. So I said, my purpose is I'm on holiday. On holiday, Mr. Wood. And I said, yes, on the holiday. And he goes, oh, in a war zone. I said, yeah, a holiday in a war zone. And he goes, you have family here. You have family. No family. No. You have friends here in Iraq. I said, no friends. So who are you traveling with, Mr. Wood? Who are you traveling with? And I went, I'm actually traveling alone, I'm just on my own. I denied my friend twice now, and he summarized, Mr. Wood, you are in Iraq, in a war zone, on your own, traveling on holiday. And I said, yeah, that's roughly it, yeah. It was a pretty shit story, really, wasn't it, really, to tell him. And anyway, just as that happened, next minute, this guy comes out. Mr. Wood, I said, yes. He said, please come with me. So they take me away down this corridor to this room, the security room. And I go in there and there's the drone on the table and there's a guy, military guy going, I'm thinking, oh God. And they look in the corner and there's Claudio. Claudio's in the corner and he's on his phone. And he looks up and he goes, Billy Ward, wow, fancy meeting you here. He's pretending that we're still not together. Pretending we were sitting next to each other on the plane, but Claudio's still going along with it. And I get my phone out because I this is definitely it now. I know that we're ringing that note. We're going to be, in a few more minutes, we're going to be in a cell and we're going to be arrested as spies in the Middle East, and we're basically fecked. That's the answer. And so I get my phone out and I'm ringing that man there. That man there is going to come and save me. And I know I'm not denying him again, but this man deserves this. Thank you. That's what he deserves. But anyway, I was proper scared. Claudio was hungry. Claudio said, can we have a sandwich? You know, I couldn't eat or drink, even, you know, I was so stressed. And but Claudio, he's proper, fearless kind of a guy. And, you know, I'm not being cruel to Claudio because he's a good friend. But when I say fearless, he's fearless because he doesn't see the danger. I could see the danger. I could see the 5 years, 6 years, 7 years in prison. He doesn't even seem to see it. It doesn't seem to affect him. And the same when I've been in different difficult places with him in Central America and South America, he just doesn't seem to see danger the way ordinary people do. And anyway, he's on his phone and I'm thinking, shit, you know? And they're asking us all sort of questions and all of a sudden this guy walks in and like an Arab, Iraqi, Kurdistani, I don't know who he was, walks in and he's aggressive and angry and he tells everybody off. He's literally telling everyone off. And before you know it, I swear to God, I didn't realize he was Claudio's fixer. Miran, his name is Miran. And telling everyone off, blah, 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 blah. And all these security guys, the military girl, they put the drone back in the box. They take our passports away. They get them stamped. They bring them back. He comes up to me, goes, Mr. Billy, you like Coca-Cola? You like Coca-Cola? They give me a Coca-Cola. Claudio gets given a Coca-Cola. 5 minutes later, we are out of that airport and we're in a nice 4x4 heading to the hotel. I swear to God, that is genuine. It doesn't matter what you do in the Middle East. It's about who you know. And our man, Miran, he knew the right people. And before you knew it, we were on our way to the hotel. And I've put a little note in there about the snatch bag. Because whenever I travel to dodgy places, I always have a snatch bag in a dodgy place. And does anyone know what a snatch bag is? Put your hand up if you know what a snatch bag is. Hand up. No, you. No, it's not a bag of snatches, okay? It's not a bag of snatches. A snatch bag... It's a bag. In fact, I brought my little snatch bag with me. Okay, so there's a little snatch bag. It's full of. It's got a compass. It's got a little knife. It's got some money. It's got a second passport. It's got little binoculars. It's got some paracetamol, some ibuprofen. It's got a whistle. It's basically when it all goes wrong, you can pick up your bag from the hotel or from wherever you are, snatch your bag, and then just leg it to the airport or leg it to the border. So that's a snatch bag. It's handy if you're traveling in places that you think there might be political unrest or whatever. And like Basingstoke, if you went to Basingstoke, I would bring a snatch bag. And but also what I carry in there are these. Do you know what these are? They're in the snatch bag. I think I usually have a couple of them. But basically, I'll put that by the camera. Can you see what that is? It's basically a wooden wedge, okay? It's a wooden wedge. And the wooden wedges are for when, it's a good tip, this, a good travel tip. When you're in a dodge place and you get in the hotel and the hotel's well dodgy, and or maybe the door's broken or the handle and the lock are broken, you get the wooden wedge, right? And you just stick it under the door. I have two. And you put them under the door and just give them a little tap under the door and it wedges against the door. So if anyone tries to push the door in, it'll wedge against the door, and the more they push, they'll end up having to take the door off the hinges to actually get in, because the more they push, the better that the wedges actually work. So it saves you, you know, if someone tries to break in the night, broken lock or no lock. I've been in loads of hotels and dodgy places and no lock. And so I get into the little two-star hotel that we stay in. It was a lovely little hotel, but very simple in that. And by now it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and I go upstairs, and I'm just so happy that we got out the airport. I'm feeling chilled, and then get into my room, 3 o'clock in the morning, and obviously my hair in the distance. I open the window and I hear, it's the call to prayer. And you know, I've got nothing wrong with the call to prayer, but it did freak me out a little bit. I'm thinking, oh my God, I'm looking over the roofs of the city and the, you know, the mosques with the minarets and the loudspeakers, and it's like right through the night. And I'm thinking, put my wedge under the door, check out the window for my escape route, another little tip, eh? Always check around the back of the hotel how to get out, always check out your window whether you can climb out. And I'm just checking out, like, and looking out, and then finally getting to bed. And I'm sitting in bed, and I'm starting to drift off, and then I hear it. There's a noise outside the room. I swear to God, there's a noise. And there's light outside, so I can see the shadow of two feet outside my door. And I'm thinking, oh my God, I didn't expect to get kidnapped on the first day of the holiday. Day one, in fact, not even day one. And the next minute, the door handle moves. And I'm up out of that bed, shorts on, dragging the t-shirt on, ready to bail out through the window because I knew that the wedges are going to give me a little bit of time, and I'm ready to go. And then all of a sudden, the door handle just goes all the way and then opens. Completely opens with no noise, no issue, not a problem, because the door opened fecking outwards, and the two wooden wedges are just sitting there on the floor doing nothing at all, and the door is completely wide open, and there's a big tall man standing there. He must be 6'4", 6'5" in a big white robe with a big black beard, and I'm thinking, oh my God. And in his hand, I swear this truth, in his hand, he's got a tray with a coffee and a croissant. A coffee and a croissant. It's like 4 o'clock in the morning, 4:30 in the morning. And he looks at the wedges on the floor. He must be about 6'4", 6'5". And he just bends down and picks up and said, Mr. Ward, are these for you? Are these yours? What are these? And I went, just give me them. Just give me them. Bastard. Oh my God. Listen, guys. Because we haven't got all night, I'm trying to give you a little bit of the story. Long story short, we ended up riding these, okay? And you'll have to come and see the show to find out how all that happened. But we couldn't get bikes, and we ended up getting two current police bikes. These aren't old police bikes, these are new police bikes. And off we go, riding from Iran, the Iranian border, all the way across to the Mosul front line. And this is Kay. We had two fixers, Kay and Miran. And this is Kay. He's Kurdish, and he's so cool. He just knows everything about the place. Him and Miran together, you're in absolutely safe hands. And they get involved in films and in supporting crews and in all sorts, in documentaries. And Kay has a book out himself. He's got his own life history tied into Kurdistan. And he was brilliant. And anyway, so this is us on the police bikes. This is us riding through Iraq. I mean, not even a helmet on bloody Claudio. Look at that. I mean, and we're just having a ball. And it was just an incredible experience. And we set off on our ride. And we're riding from the top right-hand side on the Iranian border. And we're riding all the way down. We're zigzagging and visiting all sorts of interesting places. And meeting loads of interesting people. Iraqi people, Kurdistan people. It was just incredible. But I remember this was a screen grab from my phone. Because we were using a little map called Map Me, because the satellites didn't work that well from where we were. We don't know if it was military issues or whatever, but so we use Map Me. Map Me is really cool because you can download the whole stuff into your phone, and then the GPRS, actually like low level GPRS, sort of tells you where you are, so you can follow it really well. And then you see we're going like down and down and down and down and down and getting closer to Mosul. And it was proper. I kept looking at my phone thinking, not long to go before we're in Mosul. It was like proper scary, but proper exciting. And here's us just on the road. I used to stop at these signs and say, wow, it's like watching the television news. Because that was the only time I'd ever seen these signs, going to Baghdad, going to Kirkuk, going to all these places. And there's 35K from Mosul. Then you start to realize you're near Mosul because you can hear explosions in the distance. You can see military aircraft, you can see low-flying helicopters with guys hanging out with like Vietnam kind of stuff with the machine guns and everything like that, you know? And we're driving police bikes, you know, but most of all, apart from the fear, the elements of fear, we had an incredible time meeting awesome people. And it broke the whole bubble of the Middle East for me, broke the whole bubble of Iraq and Kurdistan and everyone we met. And I swear, everyone on the whole trip were awesome. And we never got a bad word. We never got a bad smile from anyone, everyone. So on the left here, we visited a really cool temple, a Yazidi temple in Lalash. And these girls, we've met them and the parents, and you know, that's not what you expect in Iraq, is it? It's not what you expect in Kurdistan. Like, look at them, they've got like, you know, sort of I Love New York hats on or whatever. Yeah, so ordinary, cool people. Look at the picture on the right there. We popped into a couple of small towns when the schools were coming out, and the kids just like sort of attacked us. They were all over us, wanted to sit on the bikes, pressing the horns, you know, and just like kids are all over the world. Like, so children in Iraq are the same children as in Whitley Bay, are the same children as in Paris. They're just children. And it's the stuff that comes after that changes them. These were just ordinary, cool kids who really loved meeting these foreigners, these like weird looking foreigners who spoke funny, and they were on police motorbikes. And that was just awesome. And we got loads of that. This is a Pope. I met the Pope. This is Zoroastrian. I never even heard of Zoroastrian. There's so many religions across the Middle East, you know? You've got Christian, you've got Muslim, you've got Zoroastrian, you've got Yazidi. Incredible. And we met loads. We went and visited the Zoroastrian temples. We've seen Muslim temples. We've seen, you know, it was just awesome. And the guy on the left and the woman on the right, are both popes. I hope I've got that right. I'm pretty sure they're both Zoroastrian popes. And the Zoroastrian religion, by the way, that's proper weird and cool and like really cool, laid back kind of a stuff. So he's got like an Indiana Jones medal. See the Indiana Jones medal on his chest? How cool is that? Oh, I met this guy, you know, Iraqi guy. He used to get parts for motorbikes and build old bikes, old Nortons, old BSAs and that. And they used to ask soldiers during the wars, like several wars, could you get me this cylinder head? Could you get me this? Could you get me that? And he'd give them the dollars or the pounds or the euros. And then when they came back from leave, they'd bring them a new cylinder head back or a new crankcase or a new whatever. And over the years, he's built this collection of motorcycles. But he didn't speak any English, and we got that a lot. It was always difficult with the English, but he was so cool. These are some of his bikes. Well, and a lovely family. Well, look at this. We're up in the mountains and we're calling into all these different villages. We called into this village and all the kids come out, and they're all kids that want to play, and they were singing us songs and everything. It was awesome. And but look what's in the center of the village. Look what the monument is. Can you get that? Can you see that? Like in villages in Ireland and in villages in the UK, you'll have like a bloke on a horse, or you'll have a statue of someone or other. Here, they've got a bomb. A bomb. That gives you a flavour of their history, eh? A flavour for them to remind themselves, yeah? For them to remind themselves of their history when they were bombed, you know? When they were often massacred, genocide in Assyria and Kurdistan. We get to the front line, proper scary at the front line. I was. The others were saying, oh, Billy, you look a bit white. Huh? And it was proper scary, but it was proper exciting. And these guys, these are Peshmerga, they're like pretty brave, pretty courageous soldiers, renowned around the world for their bravery. And when the Yazidis were first attacked, it was 2014, when ISIS invaded Iraq, okay? When ISIS came in, you know, and they were killing and slaughtering and taking prisoners, like the sex slaves, thousands of Yazidis. And there's still thousands of Yazidis still missing. I mean, it's a terrible, terrible story. And these guys, the Peshmerga, when other forces were running away from ISIS, the Peshmerga were running forward. And so big respect for these guys. And these really looked after us while we were on the front line, while we stayed with these guys. And he looks a bit scary, doesn't he? I mean, he does look a bit scary. The other two were quite chill, but he always looked a bit scary. These had some amazing stories telling us about some of the battles that had gone on in the area. And this is their HQ, which is basically a building that they took back off ISIS. So there's loads of ISIS drawings on the wall and everything, like, you know, it's a proper strange place to be, but they were awesome. And see, they're all tooled up. See the guy on his right hand, machine gun there. This is where we slept. We slept in a room on the floor with some blankets, and there's guns everywhere. And the rule was, if anything happens in the night, if ISIS come through the windows, pick up your gun. And I'm not being funny, that gun there was next to me. And I was looking at it and it looks like pretty ancient. I mean, you know, you see the bullets are a little bit rusty around the edges and that, but the Peshmerga guy said, no problem. You push in, you pull this back, and if ice has come through the window, you. And I was going, oh yeah, I'll be all over that, mate. And we were so privileged. We met a Peshmerga general. He was only about 35, and he's on my left, so he's on the right of me on the picture as you're seeing it. And we had an evening with him. We had dinner with him. Dinner, just typical frontline dinner, plastic plates and all that. And he was incredible, with an incredible worldview. I don't mean just a soldier. He had a worldview, a politician's view. He had a view on Brexit. He had a view on everything. It was a real privilege to spend some time with these guys. And on my little slide there, it says, was it scary? Yeah, it was scary. But, we do stuff to be scared, don't we? Was it exciting? Absolutely. Would I go back? I'd love to go back now. The kids, the Kurdish people, they are phenomenal. I mean, and they so looked after us. I mean, they really did. And they've been given a bad hand. The West have let the Kurdish people down year on year on year. We've promised them the world. Go and fight ISIS and we'll support you forever. We maybe even help you get independence. So they go and fight ISIS and then we just forget about them and everyone pulls out. I mean, there's loads of travesty of what's gone on with the Kurdish people. Not to mention genocide. And I go into a lot more of this in my show. Anyway, guys, what I want to try and do is get some questions, okay? I'm coming to the end now. So the film that we made for that is, and Claudio will talk about this when I talk to Claudio on Saturday night, at 7:30. But the film went to Sky TV, and Sky TV loved it, and they cut a little teaser for it. So what I'd like to do, guys, I'd like... Matt and Rhys to set up this film now, because we're going to watch, it's only 2 minutes long, guys. We're going to watch the film, which is just a snippet of what the journey was like across Iraq. And then at the end of the film, we'll spend a few minutes talking to Matt and Rhys and take a few questions. So Matt, Rhys, can we have a look at that film now? Can we make that work, dude?
Hi, everybody.
There ain't nothing stopping us.
Definitely boyhood dream.
Get your motor running.
Head out on the highway.
These are all for you. Choose your bike.
Oh my lord.
Yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving place.
They're like, we've got to stop going to Africa and go somewhere else. Somewhere a little bit more extreme. You don't understand.
No, but you need to do something a little bit of meaning.
No,
you have to deal with the real world.
Another little welcome. Started off with like one kid on a bike, and then it's about 30 people. All right, how are you?
Cool, man.
We are filming ourselves.
I love you.
The wall is completely covered in all the names of the people that were killed.
And this museum's about the gassing, but it's actually bigger than that. It's about all sorts of other horrific disasters that have gone on over the years, right up to modern day.
Remember this from the British headlines, where the refugees are risking the lives of their whole family to escape.
You know, the sad thing is that the lesson isn't really learned.
Other town.
Wow, man, that was awesome. Just hilarious, but also really, like, really interesting, genuinely. And it's really interesting to see, like, the same sort of experiences you're having on the front line, like the generosity and how welcoming people are and the experiences you had there. And how it is, we get this all the time, this kind of scene with travellers going all around the world. And sometimes you can think, are we just going to the nice places? But you're going into a war zone there, and then you're getting that kind of generosity on the front line, all that good humour associated with it too. The feed has gone mad. There's been crying, laughing faces, for the last 40 minutes. So really well done, mate. That was so interesting. Yeah, we'll fire a few questions around and take some questions from everyone that's been going through. I've been trying to keep up with the feed, but it's been pretty tough. Hey, Reese, have you managed to get some?
I've got a few. I've had one just kind of burning in general. I'd really need to know again, Billy. Obviously, you guys kind of just rocked up in a, you know, there, and you got your bikes kind of got handed to you, essentially. I suppose, you know, would you have taken a sidecar for the duo rather than police bikes had you had the opportunity? I'm assuming you would have.
Yeah. So what I've tried to do there is give a snippet of a sort of a casual and formal way of doing my show. I do a one-man show, which is an hour and a half, like, you know, in a theatre. And so what I've tried to do there is just take a snippet. But so the pieces, there's loads of pieces missing from the story. Of course there is. But the you know, when we got there, we thought we could just go and hire bikes or even buy bikes, you know, temporarily and then sell them back kind of thing. And when we got there, we found out that mainly in Iraq, it's illegal to have big bikes. The guys with the big bikes are sort of either connected or they're under the radar. So when we went around, we couldn't buy a GS, couldn't buy a KTM, couldn't buy a 500cc bike, couldn't buy a 650, couldn't rent anything. And all we could get was little 125 Chinese things. So it was actually at the last minute, we said, right, well, let's do that then. Let's get two. And we were doing a lot of mileage. We weren't just going from the border to Mosul. We were literally, you know, the fixer, the two fixers we had, Kay and Miran, they planned loads of stuff for us to go and see. And so we were all over the place. So we needed like off-road style adventure bikes. And then we couldn't get them. We just couldn't get them. So yeah, the answer to your question is, we got to the stage where we would just ride anything. In the end, it was Hobson's choice. So we just decided to whatever we can get. And then at the last second, we got up in the morning really early. Everything's early for those people who've been in the Middle East. Like, work starts at about like 6 o'clock. So people are up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and they're in work at 6 o'clock, you know, before the heat and everything. And so we're up really early. I'm having breakfast. And the fixer, Miran, he's on the phone all the time going, and no disrespect to Middle Eastern people, but they don't seem to have that kind of spatial awareness. So like, say if I'm on a train and my phone rings, I'll go, hi, yeah, how's it going? Yeah, I'm on the train, yeah. Well, if you're from the Middle East, you go, hey, I'm on the train, how are you, Abdal? You know, it's like fucking crazy. And he was always on the phone fixing things because he's a fixer and he's always on the phone, but he would go, Billy Ward. And this morning he's on the phone and I always got a bit anxious because I didn't know what he's saying. I always got a bit anxious. And then he said, Billy, we are in a bit of trouble, man. We have to go. I said, what? It's only like 6 o'clock in the morning. He said, no, you have to go. It's the secret police. And I went, oh, shit, what? He said, secret police, they want to see you. Now, we have to go. Leave the breakfast. I said, wow, why do you want to see me? I don't know. Maybe the drone. I went, whoa, hold on a minute. The drone? That's not me. That's him. That's Claudio. Claudio, you go. I'm not going. I don't want to go. I didn't smuggle a feckin' drone. And Claudio goes, well, actually, Billy, I think you find they're asking to see you. They're not asking to see me. And I was like, oh, I don't want to go. And anyway, I persuaded Claudio to come with me. So we all went. We all went into see secret police. And we get into the city, and turns out, not so secret. Big building with secret police written down the side of it. And we go in there, and it starts off like scary, and in, like an interrogation kind of feel to it. And then, it was quite funny when I said that. He said, what is your purpose here? Why are you here? And I said, well, we want to meet other blokes who ride motorbikes. And use the motorbikes as like a bonding thing and have fun with other people with motorbikes. And he goes, you want to have fun with men on motorbikes? And I went, yeah, sort of. And he said, it is a gay thing. It's a gay thing? And I went, no, it's not a gay thing. No, there's not wrong with gay things. No, but you don't want to be gay in the Middle East, generally speaking, like, you know. So I thought, oh shit, this is all going badly wrong. And we explained to him that we felt that the motorcycle was a good connector and that anywhere we went on the motorbike, we would meet other people with motorbikes and there'd be this connection and it would help us to travel safely across Iraq because people would connect with us down there. And you know what? he absolutely got it big time. He really did get it big time. And about 2 hours later, he calls us into the yard, and there's these two police bikes. And they arranged it. They contacted the owner of the state, and they agreed to give us two police bikes. And we were on them. Claudio leaned across to me and said, "Is this serious?" And I said, "Claudio, he said, "Billy, let's just hope that that people like police, eh?" And I went, "No, you're right. I mean, I'm a bit anxious." He said, "Billy, I think we're both fucking dead. That's what that's obviously." But we couldn't say no. They just rolled over for us and give us two motorbikes. Yeah. And we couldn't say, sorry, we don't want to.
Funny, man. Yeah, it's a shame they didn't roll out a Watsonian or a Ural or something, and you could have drove straight out of there together in a sensible fashion. But, police bikes were the thing. So, mate, the big question I'm getting now is constant people saying, what's happening in the movie then? You said it's with Sky. Do you have any tips you can tell us? Are we going to get to see the actual film and stuff? Because everyone wants to see the full story from that.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'm just going to get my phone, and while you're all on, I'm going to ring Sky right now, because let's get straight onto them and say, when is the fact? It's a very fickle. I mean, Charlie will probably talk about this on Saturday. It's a very fickle industry, and when Sky got that footage, I swear, Sky went sort of ballistic on it. They rang me up and said, "Billy, we really love this. This is proper hot stuff. I mean, Mosul are still fighting. The ISIS." It's still happening, and you guys have been there and come back, and this is, we're in, we want this. And I went, wow. And I rang Claudio. Claudio was in, I think, Australia or somewhere, doing another documentary, and he said, "Billy, just say yes to everything they say. Whatever they say yes." Because I was worried about speaking on behalf of Claudio. So I was a bit, so I went to London, had the meeting with Sky, and said, "I'm speaking for me and Claudio." And I just said yes to everything. And they said, they said, "So, Billy, we're in, we love it. So, where's episode two?" And I went, "Well, episode two?" Because we were there like 3 weeks. I thought we had six episodes. The whole journey from the Iranian border across. There's easy six episodes there. But no, Sky seeing the Iraq thing, the Kurdistan thing, as episode one. And so I'm thinking on my feet, thinking, "Shit, I never thought of that." And I went, "Oh yes." Episode two, of course. No, I totally understand. Episode two is Nigeria. We're going to go to Nigeria, and we're going to find Boko Haram, and we're going to find out where them girls went. All them 300 kids. So that's episode two. And Sky go, "Wow, we love that." Episode three. Where's episode three? And I went, episode three is El Salvador. 10 years ago, kidnap capital of the world. Number one. Today, number 10. What went wrong? And basically, I hit him with three or four different. I just thought of anywhere dangerous in the world that we could go on motorbikes and try and make a connection and show, if you like, the public that it might look scary and parts of it maybe is. But actually, these people are just ordinary people, just like me and you. And just people in Iraq lockdown, people in Iran lockdown, people who are struggling now with the whole situation, just like me and you, just like our kids. It's, that's what Claudio and me wanted to do, to tell a story that even in difficult, challenging places, we didn't want to do, what's that guy, what's that British actor who always goes into the hardcore places and
Ross Kemp.
We didn't want to be Ross Kemp. In fact, we wanted to be the antithesis of Ross Kemp. I wanted to go into Nigeria, looking for Boko Haram, shitting myself. That's what I wanted to be. I didn't want to be, and here we are, I've got a revolver here. It was completely not that. So I want to make that clear. We didn't want to go in there looking tough and mean and fearless. We wanted to just tell a story about ordinary people, and we wanted to use the motorcycle as the connector, and it really worked in Iraq and in Kurdistan. The motorcycle opened doors again and again and again. And so long story short, I don't know where it is. It's a very fickle industry, and And Claudio has done his own edit, more of a very, very clear-cut documentary, fly on the wall style. And we'll talk about that on Saturday and how you can go and rent that online. But it wasn't the edit that we were wanted to do in terms of a commercial sense. But it's still a pretty cool story. And it's filmed by Claudio, and there's some excellent stuff in it. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe Sky might come back. Maybe they won't. It's a difficult one. And we've had other people who wanted to join us, like Kurt Jaeger. I don't know, you know Kurt Jaeger from Sons of Anarchy in the States. Kurt Jaeger has been on saying, "Hey, Billy, we've seen some of the clips of your stuff, and you know, I'd love to come and do the next show with you guys. When can we go? You know, I've talked to my agent, and Kurt's going, you know, so you and me and Claudio, and I'm going, woo, let's do it, baby, like you know, but it's just so hard to make this stuff work, you know. And bear in mind, we paid for all that ourselves, you know, and Claudio spent a lot of money on that trip because he went out and bought extra kit, like different cameras, the hidden cameras that we could do sneaky stuff with, like Sneaky Squirrel. So we had Sneaky Squirrel cameras and Claudio bought all that stuff himself, like, you know?
Yeah. Man, I think you need a new Claudio to come and record Claudio taking you to these crazy places. I think the footage of you in the airport saying, fucking hell, Claudio, that would make the doco, man. And I've got to tell you, I'm happy to do it. So if you want me...
Sorry, that was the Sky plan. So the Sky plan, Sky would provide a small film crew, like a discreet film crew, who would film us making the documentary. So it was like them filming us kind of thing. And that was exactly what it was about. So, you know, but we had some funny occasions where, like, you know, and Claudio is fearless. Like they'll say, no cameras, no cameras. And Claudio is just like this with the camera. And he's going, no cameras. And they push Claudio away. And as soon as they push him away, Claudio just bobs straight back in there again. And I'm whispering to Claudio saying, maybe we should put the camera down, Claudio. He's talking now. And Claudio says, keep talking to him, keep talking to him. And get his attention. And then Claudio's back on there, like, you know, we're surrounded by machine guns. And Claudio is nonstop.
Okay, so that was Billy Bike Trek, Billy Ward. Fun talk. Always love a bit of Billy nudity in my life. Great fun. Billy was a great character to have involved with the Armchair Adventure Festival. He's been on some pretty out there adventures as well and done some crazy stuff with some cool people. So always great to chat with Billy. Absolutely full of stories. It was good fun to have at the festival, especially when he started modelling those Y fronts and it led to us creating an Armchair Adventure Festival Y front, which I really didn't ever think we'd do. So one of those guys, you never know what's going to happen with Billy around. Hopefully get involved in the future too. Cracker of a talk. So next week, who are we going to have, mate?
We are going to be going back to Ollie Hunter Smart. So for those who tuned in at the weekend, Ollie was quite the regular appearance, regular person on the Adventure Festival stage. He did a talk.
Could call him Ollie Hunter Armchair.
He couldn't. His name is Smart, no. But he did a talk about his Amazon trip. He was also on our Land, Sea and Petrol panel. And he also showed his film, The Road to Independence, where he walked the length of India. So we will be going back to his talk on his trip across the Amazon. I think he walked an excessive amount of it. And he also did a lot of canoeing of the Amazon as well, mate, when he'd never done any canoeing before. So it's quite an interesting one. Maybe what we'll even do is a bonus feature next week, mate, and maybe we'll include the Q&A after his movie night or something.
We could
bolt it onto the actual thing.
We'll include the Q&A, and then what we suggest you do is we'll play his talk. We suggest you do is hop over onto his Vimeo channel, watch the film if you missed it, and then tune back into the YouTube video to watch the Q&A. That's what we'll suggest, I think, mate.
Yeah.
Because that's the way I do it. And that, right there, would be 2 or 3 hours cracking entertainment with Ollie Hunter Smart, or Ollie Hunter Armchair, as he likes to be known.
He just likes to call himself Ollie Hunter Armchair. Yeah, no, exactly. So you've got Ollie Hunter Smart coming next week. Fun fact about Billy Ward as well, which I was going to mention at the beginning. one thing you didn't know, mate, before the Armchair Adventure Festival was that you two live 5 minutes away, don't you?
Yeah, he's literally just down the road in Cullercoats Bay, which is, oh, maybe I should be telling that. That's where Billy lives. If you want to find Billy, his address is...
Number three.
Sorry about that, Billy. I'm sure he's fine. I'm sure no one's out there trying to find Billy in a bad way. Anyway, he's just down the road, and it's really nice to have such a lovely neighbour. Haven't managed to see him yet because we've been on lockdown since. No, me and Billy, if you fancy it, mate, let's go for a socially distanced walk along the beach. I'm up for that. I'm hoping to go and maybe we'll grab a pint or something when all this blows over. You know?
Yeah.
Put the world to rights.
Yeah, it'd be nice.
That'd be nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be really nice, mate. Yeah. Maybe we can do it when you come up as well. You're coming up later in the year, I think.
I'd enjoy that.
Yeah.
Can we go to that pub that's got the taxidermy dog?
Yeah, we can go to that pub, yeah, on Tynemouth High Street. What's it called?
Dog, guys. It's a taxidermy dog from the 19th century.
It's flipping old. That yeah.
An old dog, isn't it?
It is an old dog.
You know what they say about old dogs, mate?
Can't teach them new tricks.
Exactly.
You can't teach that one any new tricks, mate. No, it is done for. But that's the Northeast for you guys. If you ever want to come up here, I'll show you around. It's full of all sorts of fun stuff like that. Pretty much the only thing I know, actually, because I'm an imposter, really. I don't really know anything about it up here.
Mm. So. Yeah, we have digressed. So we've got Ollo and Armchair next week. we've just had Billy Ward. And obviously you can see Ollie Hunter Armchair right now by becoming one of our patrons, can't you, mate?
Yes, you can become a patron. It's $3 a month, which is really, you know, not much money, not much in return. $3 a month, and you can see Ollie Hunter Armchair, along with a load of other bonus content, including me and Reese talking about our trip around the world by scooter and sidecar. You can see what it's like inside a Russian banya. And if you want to, you can take it up a notch and you can become a festival producer and you can pay $5 a month. And for one of those, you get, and I've brought them this week, one of these stickers. And it says festival producer on it, Reese, like that. You can stick it wherever you want. If you ask for more than one, I'll send you more than one of these. I'm quite generous with them. If you become a patron, I can give you two or three maybe. And then you can put them wherever you like, all around the house. And then if you want to, for a serious financial commitment every month, $25 a month. So for that, you could get, I don't know, maybe a basic Sky TV package or a new phone, maybe something else you're interested in. You could become a festival director. Again, get very little in return. You do get one of these orange stickers. I'll throw one of these in too. So... you'll have a blast with it.
Well, I suppose you've got to bear in mind, mate, is that if you do get a Sky TV package, realistically, most people have probably got one program they like to watch on Sky One, really. You know, and that's once a week.
They don't give you a sticker.
No, and you pretty much are getting your favourite program through us once a week as well, the Armchair Adventure Festival program.
Exactly. So, really suggest it. Everyone on the Patreon page already knows who our bonus guest is for next week's film night. So they're already in the know. You fools have been left behind.
Unless you're watching us on our Patreon page and that you don't know right now.
In which case, thanks, guys. Yeah. So, okay, that's it for another week. Next week, back with Ollie Hunter Smart, and then who knows after that? Obviously, the film night next week. So, are we going to bring this out next week, mate? Or are we going to put this out the week after?
I don't know, but it won't be the film like next week, will it?
It's honestly, it's like Inception, this is, guys.
It should be like, it's going out, I've got a couple of weeks after the film night, if you think about it.
We had a cracking film night.
And we've got another one coming up at the end of this month.
Cheers, guys. We'll see that. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Bye.
Bye.